Martin Bormann arrived in Argentina in 1948. Pablo saw him at Inalco. Jorge Colotto met him in 1955 when Juan Domingo Perón greeted his long-term friend and paid his hotel bill in Buenos Aires. Araceli Mendez worked for him in Buenos Aires and spent almost 3 years rebuffing his advances. She kept pictures of him. The Argentine Federal Police kept a file on Bormann, much of which was burnt in the 1960s, but documents remain, which we have, and prove he and his lover Alicia Magnus stayed at the Plaza Hotel. At least 30,000 Nazis, Ustashi, Croatia's bloodthirsty animals led by Ante Pavelic, and other European fascists fled to South America after the war. They were helped by the Perons, the Catholic Church, the Red Cross, and KLM under Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands. Adolf Hitler, the worst and most evil criminal of the 20th century, often used the alias Mr. Wolf. The name Adolf comes from the High German for noble wolf. His first mistress called him Wolf, and it was as Herr Wolf that he was introduced to Eva Braun. Hitler's yacht was called the Sea Wolf, and his personal plane the Flying Wolf. His field headquarters in East Prussia, the Ukraine and France all had the word Wolf in the title.
Welcome back. We're here with the author of Grey Wolf, Mr. Gerrard Williams. Gerrard, the title of the book, Grey Wolf, how does this fit into the story?
Hitler used the pseudonym Mr. Wolf throughout his early political career. I think probably because the name Adolf is based on the old High German for noble wolf. That's where the name gets its derivative from. His headquarters throughout the war were known as the Wolf's Lair, the Wolf's Gorge. His plane was known as the Flying Wolf. Before the war, when he was introduced to Eva Braun for the first time in the photographer's studio where she worked, he was introduced as Mr. Wolf. Wolf was a big part of Adolf Hitler's strange personality. In fact, his sister, Paula Wolf, Paula Hitler, took the name Wolf herself during the war so that she could hide away from any reflected glory or whatever from her elder brother. Grey Wolf was a title which said that this was the wolf going grey. This was the wolf in exile. This was the wolf getting older. Of course, one of the most fearsome weapons of the Nazis during World War II were also the grey wolves, the submarine U-boat packs that ravaged Allied shipping in the Atlantic. And of course, it was one of those grey wolves in the final operation of the U-boats in World War II, which was known as Sea Wolf. That was its code name, that Adolf Hitler escaped via Fuerteventura to the coast of Argentina. So Grey Wolf was something that seemed to be, it's not a code name or anything like that, but it's just the wolf going grey. And that's where the name came from. It stuck. It became Grey Wolf.
Now, you showed me some clips from your documentary film. Fantastic film, by the way.
Thank you.
But one thing that really struck me in this film was it seemed that this one of the central characters, one of the big personalities, was Martin Bormann. So tell us a little about the significance of this man during the war and after.
I think Martin Bormann is one of those characters that for some reason has been sidelined by history. In various films you will see him as an ineffectual secretary. Die Untergang, Downfall, has him not as a central figure at all. He's been described by various intelligence agencies as the most dangerous man in Europe, a title that was occasionally given to Skorzeny, Hitler's favorite commando. But Bormann was the most dangerous man in Europe. Bormann was the complete power behind the Nazi throne. This guy was an economic and administrative genius who, when other more flamboyant figures in that sick regime, Goering or Goebbels or Himmler, were prancing around in their smart uniforms, designed by Hugo Boss most of the time, Goering and Martin Bormann was in the background. But it was Bormann who recognized the financial importance of not just Hitler, but the Nazi Party as a brand from very early on. He licensed Hitler's image, for instance, on every coin or every stamp, and made sure that Hitler got a portion of each sale that was made on that. I mean, it's the first example. We see it all the time now with everybody from David Beckham to Magic Johnson. I'm not comparing either of those two great guys to Adolf Hitler, but marketing a personality, marketing a brand. Martin Bormann knew all about that. Bormann also understood the real financial workings of Nazism. He'd been involved, along with his then boss, Rudolf Hess, in negotiations with American bankers and American industrialists in the 30s to finance the Nazi Party to the tune of, well, today it would be $1 billion. I think it was equivalent to the GDP of the US for 1 year in those days. So we're talking massive investment of capital and skills into Nazi Germany. Bormann isn't seen in history. I mean, there are very few pictures of Martin Bormann. You see him occasionally in group shots. Very few pictures of him. He wasn't somebody who wanted to make his presence widely known. And yet he was secretary of the Chancellery. He was secretary of the Nazi Party. Not a secretary. The secretary of the Nazi Party, the biggest organization in Germany. Bormann also understood how economics and world banking operated. And we believe, and we have the information, I think, presented in Grey Wolf pretty solidly, that from 1943 onwards, he recognized that Nazi Germany was finished in one form or another. Militarily, they were going to get destroyed. This was after the defeat at Al Alamein in the desert by the British, and then Stalingrad happened, and then the Kursk tank battles, and it was pretty obvious that the whole empire was contracting and falling apart. Unless the wonder weapons turned up, if the Nazis had got the atomics first, maybe the world would have been a different place. But from 1943 on, Martin Bormann made a decision that the capital that the German people, the Nazis, had looted and raped from the rest of Europe would be sent overseas, along with the collusion of all the German companies that we know by name today, with all their patents and all their intelligence and all their information, so that no matter what happened to Nazi Germany, that Germany could once again become resurgent after World War II. The capital would go out, and we're talking shipments of gold and bullion, and yes, we're talking shipments of concentration camp gold. But what we're talking more about here is an international banking system that worked in exactly the same way as the banking system does today. You ask a counterparty in Switzerland to transfer $5 million to your bank account in Argentina. And it is done telegraphically. This doesn't have to be submarines full of gold. It doesn't have to be paintings and art objets and everything else going out. He knew how to telegraphically transfer the wealth of the Third Reich out to Argentina. Not just Argentina, Syria, Turkey, various other neutral countries at the time who were more than willing to accept for a percentage. I think the Swiss got 6% on every transaction. Then the counterparty in Argentina would have probably got 3%. It's exactly the same way that things work today. Bormann knew it was all over, that there was never going to be an opportunity for Nazi Germany to win militarily. But he also knew that he could plan for the influence of Germany in a post-war Europe by moving all this material and wealth, I mean really significant country-buying wealth, out of Germany. And as I say, most of it went to Argentina. Some of it to Brazil as well, Paraguay and Chile, but most of it to Argentina.
I'm going to name you a few companies, and some people are going to find these names very familiar, even in today's industrial world. I've got IBM, ITT, Ford Motors, Chase Manhattan Bank.
Where would you like to start?
Mannesmann Bartelsmann, Siemens, Deutsche Bank. Did Bormann create a myriad of shell companies after the war or during the war?
Well, let's just take one major German company, ThyssenKrupp, the big steel company. From 1943 until the end of the war, they had created over 700 dummy corporations on their own outside of Nazi Germany within neutral countries. Siemens, which was named as basically an SS international operation by British intelligence in 1940 on. Siemens had offices all over the world. They were all staffed by senior Nazi members, senior party members. Siemens Argentina, for instance, was huge and you know was heavily involved in the industrial electronics, electrics side of things there. But Siemens effectively had a global operation that was bigger than German military intelligence services. And they were all loyal to the party, not to Germany, but to the party. Germany and the party are intermingled, but we have to remember that not every German was a Nazi. Far too many Germans were Nazis, but not every German was a Nazi, and not every German living overseas was a Nazi either. But companies like Siemens had links to all the major American corporations who had invested heavily in Nazi Germany from 1934, 1935 onwards. IBM, for instance, ran the Holocaust. They put in the counting machines that enabled them to process millions of Jews, gypsies, homosexuals, political people through the extermination camps. Now, you know, that was hidden for a very long time, but what has recently come out, nothing to do with our research, but better research, different research in America, shows that IBM actually had IBM employees at Auschwitz, at Buchenwald, at Ravensbrück, who were actually running these damned counting machines on the ground. It was being micromanaged by IBM out of New York. ITT, another great American company, owned 25% of Fokker Wolf, the fighter aircraft manufacturer. So American corporate money was paying to build fighters that were shooting down American boys in American bombers over German cities from 1943 onwards. I mean, I don't understand this. Henry Ford, the Ford Motor Company. It's a cuddly family American tradition. Henry Ford was the worst anti-Semite in history. His writings in the 20s and 30s had a direct influence on Hitler's Mein Kampf. He's a disgusting creature, Henry Ford. Just because he could give you any car you liked in any color you liked, as long as it was black, doesn't make him a good man. The Ford Motor Company produced over a third of all trucks used by the German army in World War II. Trucks that took German soldiers to fight Americans, Canadians, and British troops on the beaches in Normandy.
So let me get this straight. While the war was going on, while US servicemen and British servicemen and Allied forces were fighting the Reich, American money was coming through places like the Union Bank of New York, the Harriman Brothers,
Manhattan,
Two Farben Corporation, and all these other companies like Ford. The same money was at the same time coming in as we're fighting the Germans.
Yeah, and profits are going back. So, you know, everybody's making money out of this. I mean, that's the disgusting thing. The most amazing thing for me is that we'll take just ITT and the Ford Motor Company at the time. And Ford will hide all this. They'll say, no, these were our German subsidiaries. We didn't have anything to do with it. Well, the documentation is coming out, I'm sorry. And we're finally knowing what the truth is. Their plants were also off the bombing lists. We weren't allowed to bomb them during the war, despite the fact they're creating huge amounts of material for the Nazis' war effort. And at the end of World War II, a couple of American bomber groups made a mistake, saw them as targets of opportunity, and bombed both ITT and the Ford Motor Company plants. Well, ITT and Ford Motor Company took the American government to court after the war and got millions of dollars in reparations. The American government gave them millions of dollars to say sorry that we bombed your Nazi war material producing factories that you were making a profit out of. Well, you know, Hitler escaping to Argentina, shocking enough. When you find out that companies that are still around today, not just German companies, who have Hugo Boss, great example, designed all the SS uniforms. There's a Hugo Boss in every street corner of every major city now. Well, I don't know if that's right. I don't know how I feel about that. Do I feel good about a company that made its name and its fortune out of Nazi Germany still being able to make profits today? I don't know. Ask a corporate lawyer. But the same is true about IBM, ITT, Siemens, the Ford Motor Company. The list is virtually endless. It was all about making money. I mean, the sacrifices that my father's generation made, my dad was a combat soldier for 6 years. And was wounded twice. The sacrifices his generation made seemed at the time to be a great crusade, a necessary crusade against the evils of this most pernicious, vicious, fascist system. And yet, at the same time, there were people making a load of money out of it.
Do you think this is one of the reasons why Hitler's escape to Argentina and all the top Nazis was kept a secret because there was a vested interest
post-World War II? Completely vested interest. I think that we have Alan Dulles to thank in great part for this. Head of OSS CIA post-war, but also OSS station chief in Switzerland during the war. And we have information that Dulles had contacts with many high-level Nazis, including Bormann, throughout the end period of the war. They were negotiating all over the place. Now, interesting enough, Dulles had been a corporate lawyer with his brother, John Foster Dulles, in Germany before the war had happened. He knew Martin Bormann. I'm not sure if he'd met Hitler, but he knew Bormann and he knew most of the people within the chancellery, within the senior levels of the party. His contacts weren't the only ones. I mean, you go on with book two, deals with John J. McCloy a great deal. McCloy in 1950 was running West Germany for the American government, and he freed all the industrialists who'd been put away at Nuremberg. By 1952, there were no Nazis left in jail, effectively. None of the big Nazis. One of the major Nazi industrialists said at Nuremberg, "I don't care what you do, we've got so many friends in Washington, we'll be out soon." And they were. It's all about making money. It's one of the sickest parts of the untold story of World War II. And that collusion, that interlinking between American big business and aspects of the intelligence community enabled Hitler and Bormann and much of their wealth to leave. They knew where the bodies were buried. If they'd come out and named the Americans who were involved in this, I don't think that America, as a democratic nation, would have put up with it.
When we come back, the reemployment of thousands of ex-Nazi officers.
Post-war, Germany was run by people who had gone home, taken off their SS uniforms or their Nazi Party uniforms, had put on their Hugo Boss suits, and had gone back to work.